Does the rind length matter? And by now, most of you have already decided that I'm a lunatic. Of course the rind length matter, particularly how can I even ask this question after the great talk Jonathan Turner gave before me. And most people, many people in fact, in next generation sequencing community think that in 1.5 years from now, when Pacific Biosciences will roll out new sequencing machine, short-read sequencing will probably die. I wanted to argue, talk a little bit more about this, and since you are stuck with lunatic for the next 30 minutes, I will try to elaborate on this a little bit. We started working on short-read fragment assembly even before the first short-read was generated. But we are no pioneers in short-read assembly, and I want you to meet the real pioneer of short-read assembly, the great Leonard Euler, who lived 250 years ago. We'll talk a little bit more about what he really is, about his contribution to the area of short-read sequencing. But I also wanted to say that the intellectual idea of short-read sequencing is not new. It's at least 20 years old. Many of you remember that when sequencing by hybridization was introduced, it was introduced as a technology for short-read sequencing. And when Affymetrix was started, the company was started to do short-read sequencing called sequencing by hybridization. It's just an accident that this technology for short-read sequencing never worked. It turned into multi-billion dollar DNA array industry and spectacularly failed. But the story of short-read sequences didn't start 3-4 years ago. It started 20 years ago. Despite the fact that sequencing by hybridization failed, the computational aspects of sequencing by hybridization is well studied. In fact, in my PhD 20 years ago, I showed that sequencing by hybridization problem, which is essentially short-read sequencing problem with ideal error-free reads, can be solved in polynomial time using two ideas. One idea comes from Euler, which is 250 years old, and another idea comes from De Bruyne, another great 20th century mathematician. 15 years ago, Uduri and Waterman noticed that this idea can actually be used not only for sequencing by hybridization, but for mundane sequence, Sanger sequencing also. And in some sense, the discussions that we have now about how to assemble genomes with short reads are not really new. They started 20 years ago. And to introduce you to these ideas, I have to give a baby introduction into algorithm 101. So here's the first problem we have to cover, so-called Hamiltonian cycle problem. You are given a graph or network, and you need to find a cycle in the network, or a path, if you will, that visits every node exactly once. Very natural problem, but intractable. Nobody today can solve it. And probably will never be able to solve it. At least that's what computer scientists believe. They believe that this problem is NP complete or intractable. Leonard Euler lived in the city of Königsberg before he was recruited by Russian Empress Catherine the Great II to come to St. Petersburg and start Russian Academy of Sciences. But he lived in this city, let's say here, and he was a strange man. He liked to make a walk. And during one of these walks, he decided, can I really start in my house, visit every bridge exactly once, pass through every bridge exactly once, and return back? He quickly realized that he can't. And then he developed the theory of how to solve this type of problem. Can we visit every bridge once? And it gave rise to so-called Eulerian cycle problem. Given a network or a graph, find a path in this graph that visits every edge in the graph. For example, here we visit every edge, not node, because node may be visited as many times as you want, but you're allowed to visit every edge exactly once. In difference from the previous Hamiltonian problem, this problem is tractable. It can be solved even if the graph and network has bazillions of vertices. It's a very efficient algorithm. So the problems sound extremely simple. It's almost the same formulation. In one case, you talk about nodes. In another case, you talk about edges. But the solutions are dramatically different and complexity is dramatically different. Now, a brief 1 minute review of the classical overlap layout consensus technologies in DNA sequence. That's how human genome was assembled. This is the genome. Red portions show repeats. So for every reads from the genome, we generate a node. And then we connect two nodes by an edge if the corresponding reads overlap. Okay? For example, in this case, this read and this read overlap, we connect them. And then it looks like the only thing is needed is just to walk in this graph from the beginning to the end. And then we'll reconstruct the genome and in this way explain all reads. But not that quick. Please notice that because of the repeat, we also have some bad connections here. And in reality, the resulting graph looks like this. Finding Hamiltonian paths in this case, which means visiting every node, is not trivial. Imagine how difficult it is to find a Hamiltonian path in the graph with these millions of vertices that would represent current assembly projects. 7 years ago, we proposed something different called repeat graph. And repeat graph works like this. Think about DNA as a thread and coat every repeated region, in this case, red by glue. Imagine what happened with the thread if we start gluing all the repeats together. Let's think of what's happening. So first, maybe first and second repeat will find each other, and it will be something like this, they're about to glue. Then maybe all the three repeats will find each other, and finally will glue into something like this. What problem do we need to solve in this graph to reconstruct the genome? Remember, this middle edge has actually multiplicity 3, so it's three edges represented as one. The problem that we need to solve, we need to visit every edge exactly once. And then every such pass through the graph will correspond to reconstructed genome. And this is exactly the Eulerian problem for which, thanks God, we have efficient algorithm. So in this case, after this idea was introduced, we really had two alternatives. We can either try to solve intractable Hamiltonian path problem in this graph, or we can try to construct the repeat graph and solve Eulerian problem. And that's pretty much how it standard when we introduce it. And just to illustrate you how this repeat graph works, this is a repeat graph of a bacterial genome. Black edges show cantiques, and red edges show repeats. There are clear connections between cantiques and repeats. Certain repeats connect certain cantiques. Of course, there are many types of repeats. There are dozens of different types of repeats. Every red edge corresponds to a single type of repeat here. And so that's what Eulerian approach provides. The classical approach provides something different. It simply provides collection of cantiques, and it's not clear how they are connected. We will see later why it is crucially important for assembly. So now you probably already noticed that I cheated. I showed you how to transform the genome into the repeat graph by just gluing repeats. But we don't have the genome. It is our goal to construct the genome. What we so I didn't explain you anything. What we really have is the collection of reads. And the puzzle remains how to transform this collection of reads into the genome. It's actually a reverse problem to what I've described. What we showed 7 years ago is that you actually can take reads, transform them into the repeat graph, and then transform the repeat graph into the genome. So when I presented it first time, 8 years now ago in Cold Spring Harbor, everybody thought that I'm a lunatic, of course. And I was very pleased to see that essentially all short read assemblers today using Eulerian ideas. They're all New Blair, all passes, Velvet, and Abyss that was just published are all Eulerian assemblers. And indeed, in some sense, Singerian classical Celeros style assembly essentially died. I didn't see any new development in recent year. And I remember in 2001 when I presented it for the first time, I predicted that in a few years, Singerian assembly will die. But it took just not a few years, but maybe six, 7 years to die. Now, what I also like about Eulerian assembly, it's extendable. It's very durable and can be applied in different situations. For example, protein sequencing is unsolved problem. People don't have high throughput technique today for sequencing proteins. But if you simply take mass spectra for which sequences are not available and corresponding peptides are not available and start gluing them in the same way we glue repeats in our approach to fragment assembly, then you can start sequencing proteins. You can may ask, well, what to sequence protein for if we can soon sequence all DNA and then derive proteins? As this example illustrates, there are still many applications where you would love to sequence proteins. From this, you probably at this point feel that fragment assembly with the introduction of Fullerian approach is very simple. I hide it, hid a few details that I will try to show you. First thing, this wonderful Fullerian machinery works for error-free reads. And the algorithmic technology breaks down as soon as the reads start having error. Why? Because if you think about reads with errors, instead of a nice graph shown by thick edges here, you will have graphs with many bulges because every edge introduces bulge. So imagine graph with a million edges and tens of million bulges and try to deal with this. This is a very challenging problem. So when we introduced this approach, the first issue to resolve was so-called error correction. So the problem is that in already an assembly requires accurate reads. It cannot work with inaccurate reads. But to correct errors, so to assemble a genome, you need first to correct errors and reads. But traditional approach to correct errors and reads, you first need to assemble the genome, a catch-22. So what we introduced is an approach that allows you to correct errors and reads and achieves remarkable efficiency of this process. We were able to reduce errors by a factor of 50, essentially making most reads error-free. And today, essentially all recent approaches to fragment assembly use error correction ID, including both Sengerian approaches and next-generation approaches. So that's nice, but what I showed you with error correction allows you to transform already rather accurate reads, let's say 1 or 2% accurate, into extremely accurate. It doesn't allow you to work with these reads where error rates, let's say 3, 4, 5, 10, maybe 20%. And if you look at the Illumina error profile, it remains decent until certain point in the suffix, but then it gets out of control. In prefix it's good, but in suffix of the reads, it becomes very bad. And we cannot, there are currently no technique to correct this portion of the reads where errors start exceeding certain threshold. So what we recently showed is that it's actually possible to start assembling reads even if there is 20% error rates in these reads. For us, there is nothing new because mass spectra, if you translate them into error rates, feature much more than 20% error rate. And we showed last year that we can still assemble mass spectra into proteins. How do we do this? Remember repeat graph? So we use repeat graph as a guide for error correction, even if corresponding errors in the read becomes very high, let's say 20%. How do we do this? Imagine a read, imagine there are errors here, but of course you don't know where the errors are. But what you can do, you can map this read to repeat graph, and in this case there are two possibilities. You can either go this way or you can go this way. The version of top has very few errors. The version on the bottom has many errors. Which one would you choose to correct errors? Of course, you would choose one on the top, and that gives you an idea where the errors are. So we combine repeat graph. We now use repeat graph for correcting errors. And then we use a number of graph simplification techniques to transform this monstrous graph. Even after reducing errors by a factor of 50, the graph still remains complex and requires certain algorithmic processing. Let's see how it works. First, I wanted to show you benchmarking with some tools. We try nearly all of them. We came to the conclusion that Velvet is the best, so I will show you only the comparison with Velvet. So this shows you, so here are the top K contigs, top largest contig, and here is the cumulative length. So ideally, you want a graph that looks like this. The higher, the better. Okay, and you see that both Velvet and our assembler actually produce identical assembly. Expect no less from any Eulerian assembler, because remember, they are guided by a serum. And there is actually a repeat graph that allows you to give up a bound. And in this case, this assembly is essentially, the fact that these curves are very similar essentially tells you, you cannot do better. They almost reached optimal assembly. However, Velvet, when you start introducing creeds, let's say 50 base pairs reads, where suffix is inaccurate, Velvet cannot process the last 15 bases. And of course, this is an outdated side because Illumina already introduced much longer reads, but everything needs to be now multiplied by 2 maybe, maybe even by 3. So Velvet doesn't see, it's an excellent assembler, but it cannot process portions of the reads where error rate exceeds 2%. And as a result, Euler starts outperforming, in this case, Velvet. So this is one thing. And another thing that is very important for this talk is the comparison in the case of real mate paired reads. And I will illustrate it for the case of E. coli genome. The assembly is actually quite good. But I wanted to introduce what are the ideas behind this assembly, why this idea eventually lead to the question, does the read length matter? Here's the idea, and it's not new. We introduced it again 8 years ago. So what Euler does, it transforms mate pairs, which is read, gap of length D, in other read, into mate reads, which are essentially continuous reads by filling in the gap with real nucleotides. How can we possibly do it? We don't know what is inside gap because we only have access to two nucleotides. Let's see how we can do it. Suppose we have left mate and right mate. We can map them to the repeat graph. They are somewhere located on the repeat graph. We know that the distance between them D. Can we find a path from here to here of length D? Of course we can, because repeat graph tells us the only path in this case is right here. Right? So we just, and here's a real nucleotide, so we can fill in this gap. Now, if we have it, then we just transform mate pair into very long read of length equal to the span of the mate pairs. Now, of course I'm painting, let me just reiterate it. So suppose you have a genome, you construct repeat graph, and then you look at the different mate pairs. So this is one of the mate pairs. You have left mate, right mate, you don't know what is inside. But when you map them to the read, you see the only way to go from here to here is through the red edge. So you fill in the, this gap in the reads. And you continue doing this for different reads. Now, with this, this at hand, what we can do, and it really illustrated here, if you would not have repeat graph, you would not be able to do this because you don't know how to move from one quantic to another. And that's kind of an illustration that repeat graph, this procedure allows to greatly simplify the repeat graph after this transformation are done. Now, I'm painting a rosy picture because I'm somehow assuming that it's trivial to transform mate pair into mate read. In most cases, it is indeed trivial because in most cases there is only one pass between left and right read. But there are cases, of course, when there are, in this case, for example, between this left mate and right mate, there are one pass and another pass. And you sometimes don't know which is the correct filling of the gap. And Velvet and all passes and all use essentially different approaches to kind of figure out what is inside the gap. And now we come to the question, does the read length matter? So my argument is very simple. Imagine a case, and it's a real case for our E. coli assembly. So you, imagine just arbitrary case. You deal with this 50 base pairs long read separated by a gap of length 300, which means that the span equals insert length plus 2 time read length, which is 400. If you are able to transform all mate pairs into mate reads, you're effectively dealing with these reads, 500 nucleotides long, which means the read length doesn't matter. Now, let's go a little bit further. But The question is, I'm correct if it is possible to transform all mate pairs into mate reads. Let's see what's happening. So for real example, if you take real E. coli data, then the efficiency of transformation of reads, mate pairs into mate reads, is very high, 98.8. Okay? And the N50 size is 61K. If we artificially extend reads by up to 100 nucleotides, the efficiency just slightly increases, N50 size doesn't change. So Illumina recently announced they increase the length of reads from 35 to nearly 100. From what follows from here, for E. coli assembly with this particular parameter, it's irrelevant. It doesn't give any bucks on money. The assembly quality remains the same. However, if we look a little bit further and ask the question, let's go down in the length of the read. Maybe we can assemble with these 10 nucleotide long reads. No, it won't work, because when you start reducing the read length, all of a sudden, almost immediately, efficiency of transformations drops. Why? Because the repeat graph remains so tangled that there are multiple possibilities for passes between left and right mate pairs. And as a result, it's dropping very quickly, and which means that a small drop in read length greatly deteriorates assembly. With what it means? It probably means that there is a breakpoint, something that we call read length barrier. Before reaching this read length barrier, when the read length is smaller than this barrier, it is extremely important to continue increasing the read length. But after reaching this breakpoint, it doesn't really matter from the perspective of genome assembly. It won't improve significantly the quality of your assembly. Now, this is, by the way, for E. coli genome, for bacterial genome E. coli. We believe 30 nucleotide with this particular parameters for the span, it may be an optimal assembly. There is no point to increase it further. But if we go to east, then the situation will change, because it depends on the complexity of the genome and complexity of the repeat graph. For every genome, there is its own breakpoint barrier. And in this case, it also, of course, depends on the span. It clarifies that the distance between reads, the size of the gap, is extremely important in de novo assemblies and gives you kind of hint of what is the optimal gap if you wanted to do de novo sequencing. Now, let's see. For yeast, for example, it is 45 nucleotide with a span 400, but it is for a fixed span. What happened? That's actually 400 nucleotide, I believe. What happened if we start changing both span and the length of the read? Would we see how it the interplay between this parameter? And the million problem question for short reads, and probably even for long read companies, what is the read length barrier for serious genomes? Okay, it's clear already that bacterial genome can be assembled very well with this short read technology, but can we assemble complex genome with this short read technology? And here's kind of first result based on simulation. I will show you clearly how this read length barrier looks like. So this is span of mate pairs. This is read length, and this is N50 size. And this is chromosome X, human chromosome X. And N50 size here actually quite gigantic. It is tens of millions nucleotides. Admittedly, these are simulations, and with some idealized data. But you can clearly see that for every size of the span, in the beginning, there is the quality of assembly is very small, and then almost immediately, the N50 becomes growing. And that's where the read length barrier is defined. Similarly, if you fix the length, the read length, and continue in this direction, for example, this is clearly the area where the assembly quality is not very good. Then you can say that, for example, for chromosome X, there is, by the way, a dramatic difference in quality for assembling with these gaps 5K and 6K. And this, of course, related to line repeats and other repeated elements in human genome. But you can kind of guess what would be the optimal choice of parameter to achieve efficient assembly. Now, these are all simulation and should be taken with a grain of salt. For each genome, for Arabidopsis genome, the picture is very similar. Clearly, there is a read-length barrier which almost immediately arises, very sharp turn. So I think I will probably stop at this point because I have only 2 minutes left. I just need to say that in March, we released a new version of Euler USR with some improved capability. You're welcome to visit the website. And this work was mainly done by very talented student and later postdoc Mark Chason in my lab. And Dima Brinza is another postdoc who's been working on error correction and threading. So they published a paper. So it was a paper in Genome Research with the title, Does the Read Length Matter? Came out in December. In January, they both were headhunted by the companies who apparently either don't believe that the read lengths matter or maybe believe that the read lengths matter. And also, the development of Eulerian approach was in work for many years now, and I worked with different people, Rob Lipschitz at Affymetrics. We've been collaborating on different aspects of ASBH. Hai-Shi Tang, my former postdoc, now professor at Indiana, and Mike Waterman worked on the first version of Euler. Glenn Tesler, professor of mathematics at UCSD. Serafim Batsoglu at Stanford is a partner of CRIME, trying to figure out how to deal with these large assemblers. And the work on antibody sequencing I mentioned is the work with Nuno Bandera and Jenny Lil at Genentech. That's all.
So you talk about the assemblies being similar for different read lengths, but what about the computation required? So if you're talking about mammalian genome, clearly longer reads would make your life easier. So basic time if you wanted to do a mammalian assembly with 35 hertz.
Well, today nobody can do mammalian assembly de novo with short reads. I think the conclusion from my talk is that there are tremendous algorithmic possibilities to improve assembly, and we are in the very, after 20 years of studies of fragment assembly, we are still in the very beginning of exploring them.
Pavel, you spoke about the length of the distance between the mates. How important is the variation?
That's an excellent question. There is currently belief that the variation is extremely important. It's important to keep in tight. I agree, but nobody yet explored the idea of adjusting mate pairs. Wouldn't it be wonderful to have mate pairs separated by fixed distance? Everybody would love it. No, of course, experimental technology cannot achieve it, but can we achieve it algorithmically? And I believe we can. With this repeat graph, we can just start moving mate pairs to ensure that they are the same distance apart all the time. And then all of a sudden, our library preparation becomes virtually extremely accurate library, defining the distance up to one nucleotide. So that's the idea that we are using in these simulations.
Probably I didn't understand the whole thing very well, but how do you use the SNPs?
De novo assemblers don't care that much about SNPs. The first order of business is to assemble genome, and it's already hard. And then later, after the genome is assembled, we will find SNPs.
Yeah, can you tell us a little bit? If you think this concept of the error correct can work with mixed communities, so if you have trying to assemble metagenomes, for example?
I am not sure, because so error correction is always associated with error corruption, because the cost of error correction is small amount of corrupted reads. For de novo assembly, it is okay. Many people demonstrated that it's perfectly fine. But for metagenomics community with huge variations, I'm not sure. Nobody studied it.
You showed us the interplay between Hi. I know I'm short in you showed us the interplay between the insert size and the read length for plants and mammals. But for those of us who consider bacteria the absolutely most important organism on the planet, can you tell us about where you think that transition occurs to where you might start to get assemblies with, you know, a really small number of contigs or hopefully even a single contig?
We can remember these curves were computed for every span and for every possible read length. Are we talking about real assemblies? Then we need to generate data with very different spans, very different variations in the span, and very different read lengths. We know that assembly with 35 nucleotide long reads separated by very small gap is already pretty good, 70 kb and 50 size. Imagine what will be happening when people start generating gap of size 2,000. And if they're able to carefully go through this, imagine what will be happening with this mixed library. So, but it is still requires probably a year of algorithmic work to implement all these things into software. So I cannot tell you, if you give me particular data sets with this gap size and read lengths, we will assemble it and give you the answer. But
so one last question.
Hi, you mentioned that in oil simulations you always assume a high coverage. So my question is, so what kind of coverage you need to be sufficient for a successful assembly? And also, when there's low coverage, does it really matter?
So by high coverage, we usually assume the coverage equal, roughly, to the length of the read. Let's say if reads are 50 nucleotides long, we assume coverage equal 50, maybe more, to ensure that nearly at every position there is a read that starts. That's a normal assumption for many bacterial genomic sequences. So we assumed in human simulation, we assume the same thing.